Yes, only that can I answer because very limited of the information about this code. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Widya. So we go to the next presenter. Is there no one wants to ask Dr. Sugiono, Mr. Sugiono?
Mm-hmm.
Please. Are you ready, Mr. Sugiono? Are you there? Sugiono Saputa. Yes. Yes. Okay. I can see you.
Sorry.
I don't see any question here in the chat box, so I will ask you. Actually, it's very interesting for me, like you and study about the frog meat, because I think frog meat is not really quite popular as like sheep or goat or cow, beef meat. Yeah. So I'm just wondering which countries that Indonesia exporting of this frog meat? Do you know it?
Yeah. Usually, yes. The frog meat is not quite popular in Indonesia, but it's a export commodity which is mainly exported to Europe, such as France, Belgium, and Luxembourg, and other maybe Scandinavian countries. Yeah.
Oh, so what do they use? Is there like for medicine or
no? Yeah, they use it as a food. So it's a protein source. Yes.
Oh really? I just know it.
Yeah, the frog leg meat is a France cuisine. It's very popular in France, but yes, not in here.
Okay. Oh, I just know it. Thank you. And do you think that frog meat is a kind of bush meat, such as bat meat?
Yes, because they mainly they are exported from the wild. Some hunters, they catch the frog from forest or even paddy field.
Okay, yeah, thank you, that's very interesting. So we go to the next presenter, Mr. Bayu Andri Atmoko. Are you there?
Yes, miss, I'm here.
Yeah, maybe you can turn on your video. Yes. Okay. Yeah, a little bit. Yeah, okay. So we don't have question here, I think. No one asked. So I have a question for you. Actually, you said that the correlation is highest with the chest-curd, but you said the best predictor is chest-curd and body length, right?
Yeah, right.
Yeah. So in practice, do you think it's quite easy to measure the chest curd and body length for local farmers? It's because you said that the local farmers, they usually don't have a scale for the cows, right? For the application of your conclusion. Do you think it's quite easy for the farmers to measure to predict the body weight by chest curd and body length?
Thank you for this question. And I think very interesting about this is the application of the results for my study. And I think we can apply for the small farmer in this field. Because for chest curd, this is the very best predictor, and I think farmer, this is easy for for me serve the chess court, and they just need to in Indonesia we call it pita ukur, like this in the cellar, and we arrange for the maybe for the predictor with the formula, something like that, and this is the I think is easy to apply the prediction of the body weight. I think in the similar livestock in cattle or in goat, I think just goat is the best predictor, and we can see the formula for the prediction of the body weight. In the usually use the chest cut. I think it's too easy to apply the study for the small farmer. Thank you.
So usually they have the meters that they can just bring it from their home.
Right? Yeah, we suggest and maybe in my laboratory we have a community service, and we give them to the farmer for the scale pita ukur.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Bayu. We have one last question for Sugiono. It will be
something like that.
In
the farm in the.
Okay, so for Mr. Sugiono, this question is: there are two genus of bacteria that you have isolated, Salmonella and Listeria. Did you sequence the bacterial DNA isolates to confirm the bacteria species? This is from Dr. Syariful Rizal.
Yep. Okay. Yes. Thank you for the. Sorry.
It's
yes.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you for the questions. So we performed two presumptive tests for two genus of bacteria, Listeria and Salmonella, and we also performed the bacterial culture to isolate these two bacteria. But unfortunately, we only have Salmonella from this presumptive test, and it's already identified with a 16S gene analysis. We also identified several bacteria as previously presented in the slide. For example, Citrobacter, Klebsiella, Chrysobacterium, and also Macrococcus. Yes, and also Salmonella. They all already identified according to 16S RNA genes. Yes, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Sugiono. I think that's all for the session two today. So I will give the session three back to Dr. Danny. Please, Dr. Danny.
Okay, I will thank you, Dr. Sastrin. So right now we going through to the third session. There is any three presenter again. The first is with the paper ID 38090 with the title Performance of Broiler Chicken Supplemented with Porang Glucomannan and Bacillus subtilis. And then the second presenter with the paper ID 38098 with the title is The Increase of Ruminant Population Based on the Potential of Agriculture Waste as Animal Feed in Aceh Tamiang District. And the third is that with the paper ID 38108, with the title The Tenderness Quality of Sinjai Superior Kampung Chicken Meat, Kampung Chicken Meat by using marinated of pineapple rind powder at different marinated time. Okay, I hope the presenter is already here and ready for the Q&A. So I remembering all of the participant and the presenter. If you have a question, just write it down directly in the chat room, and I will read it after the videos. Okay. Please, the co-host to play the videos. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming to this presentation. It's great to see you all. Let us introduce ourselves. We are Yani Niken Larasati, Eni Harmayani, Jaka Widada, and Nurliani Nurliani. We will present about performance of broiler chicken. Promoters or AGP as feed additive for livestock, including poultry, have been prohibited. AGP made unbalanced microflora in the digestive tract of poultry. AGP also left residues of poultry carcass and unsafe for consumption. So the imposition of a ban on the use of AGP and feed encouraged intensive research to find alternatives to AGP. Prebiotic, probiotic, and symbiotic were alternatives to AGP for animals. They have positive effects on chicken based on other research, like reducing pathogenic bacteria and related to the higher performance of broiler chickens. The prebiotic currently being developed was glucomannan. Glucomannan could be obtained from porang. Glucomannan has beta bonds where the chickens was unable to digest beta bond, so glucomannan was potential to be prebiotic. Bacillus can produce spores in extreme environmental condition. This is suitable for environmental of broiler raising. Porang glucomannan and Bacillus subtilis can be combined into symbiotic. So our study was designed to investigate the effect of porang glucomannan and Bacillus subtilis on performance of broiler chickens like body weight, feed intake, and conversion ratio or FCR. The material used were 200-day-old chicken, New Lohman from Java Confit, porang glucomannan and porang flour from Faculty of Agricultural Technology Universitas Gadjah Mada, Bacillus subtilis natto IFO 3335 from Universitas Gadjah Mada, and Basalfit. The first table is Basalfit formulation on the right side. And the methods used, the chicken raised 35 days with 5 treatments and 4 replications. The treatment were T0 control, T1 prebiotic porang glucomannan, T2 probiotic Bacillus subtilis, T3 symbiotic porang glucomannan and Bacillus subtilis, T4 symbiotic porang flour and Bacillus subtilis. Feed intake and body weight were recorded weekly at 1st until 5th weeks of age, and then feed conversion ratio is from feed intake divided body weight gain. This is the results and discussion. For the first is body weight. The results show that there was significant difference on body weight of broiler chickens between T1, T2, T3, T4, and control from 2nd until 5th week. T2 and T3 were significantly different than others in the first week. And then supplementation of prebiotic, probiotic, and symbiotic had higher body weight than control. Feed additives such as prebiotic, probiotic, or symbiotic can form balanced microflora in the gastrointestinal tract. Balanced microflora improve the immunity and digestive efficiency in the villi of broilers. So the nutrient could be converted into body mass. Better digestibility and absorption of nutrient were the main mechanism that led to higher growth performance of broiler chickens in response to the addition of feed additive. This is why the result could be happen like this table. And the second of results and discussion is feed intake. There was no significant difference on feed intake of broiler chickens in the study. This case happened because chickens fed with same nutrient contents of feed in all treatments. Chickens were given the same protein energy of ration. If the energy was fulfilled, chickens stopped eating. Prebiotic, probiotic, and symbiotic were also only added at the low percentage level. The third is feed conversion ratio, or FCR. Feed conversion ratio of broiler chickens between T1, T2, T3, and T4 then control in the fifth week was significantly different based on table. The dietary treatments had lower FCR than control in the finisher phase. Feed additives like prebiotic, probiotic, or symbiotic were more efficient to convert feed into body mass during the rearing stage. It is also suggested that the effect of the additives may be worthless under benefit management or environmental conditions. The balanced microflora between beneficial bacteria and pathogenic bacteria caused the improvement of villi growth. The higher villi created a wider surface area to increase the activity of digestive enzymes and absorption of nutrients that were converted into body mass. So the treatments had better FCR than control. From this study, we can conclude. First, treatments among prebiotic porang glucomannan, probiotic Bacillus subtilis, symbiotic porang glucomannan and Bacillus subtilis, symbiotic porang flora and Bacillus subtilis, were not significantly different. The second, supplementation of prebiotic porang glucomannan, probiotic Bacillus subtilis, symbiotic porang glucomannan and Bacillus subtilis, symbiotic porang flora and Bacillus subtilis, increased body weight and decreased feed conversion ratio of broiler than control without any negative effect of dietary treatments on feed intake. Thank you for your attention. Have a nice day.
Okay, the next videos, please.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you for coming to this presentation. I'm glad to see you all. Well, ladies and gentlemen, in this presentation, we are going to discuss about the increase of ruminant population based on the potential of agricultural waste as animal feed in Aceh Tamiang district. Now we will divide our presentation into four sections. There are introduction, material, result, and the conclusion. The first slide is we are going to discuss about one of the step to reduce feed limitation is the utilization of waste as a source of feed for ruminant. Utilization of the feed ingredient can reduce feed cost and increase livestock population. The development of beef cattle and buffalo business is expected that it can increase the population leading to increased supply of domestic beef and buffalo. Animal husbandry technology innovation play an important role in supporting the development of an integrated agricultural model. The application of technology in the integrated system is more emphasis to meet the need of animal feed through processing plant waste so the farmer can overcome the problem of feed availability by utilizing agricultural waste in the integrated system. This integrated system is very profitable because livestock can be used as feed. This paper aim to examine the potential source of feed for ruminant and effort to maintain the continuity of feed availability associated with ruminant livestock development strategies. Thus, it hope that ruminant livestock business will be more efficient and profit benefit for breeder, especially in Aceh Ruminant District. Study are expect to provide important information to related agency and the community and breeder in the context of developing ruminant by utilizing agricultural waste. Place of the research is the research was conducted from January to December 2018 in Aceh Tamiang District. This research is by secondary data is from the data was obtained from the Central Statistic Agency of Aceh Tamiang District in 2018. Based on secondary data, the calculation of number of livestock unit, agricultural waste product, livestock capacity will be calculated. In this slide, we can see Aceh Tamiang is the district is adjacent to the capital city of North Sumatra Province, making it the main gateway and has the opportunity to grow and interact with the other district and make mobility of goods and service, including agricultural and livestock production, quite high. The agricultural and livestock sector have an influence of the economy of Aceh Tamiang District. Table 1, we can see the area with the highest population of cattle was Seruwei sub-district, and the lowest sub-district is in Kuala Simpang City with 27 cow with percentage 0.07. Table 2 show the area with the highest population of buffalo, namely Karang Baru sub-district with a total of 70 cow with a percentage 70 buffalo with the percentage of 40.23, followed by Kejuruan Muda sub-district and Bandar Pustaka and Bendahara sub-district. And the lowest sub-district is in Sekerak sub-district with 11 buffalo with a percentage of 6.32%. Based on table 3, it can be seen that the highest total production of agricultural waste is in the Manyak Payet sub-district, around 5,000 ddm tons per year, followed by the Bendahara sub-district with the 3,000 ddm tons per year and Karang Baru sub-district with 3,000 ddm tons per year. Kuala Simpang City is the sub-district with the low production because this sub-district is the capital of Aceh Tamiang District. And then the agricultural commodity producing the most scattered agricultural waste in all district were from rice, corn, and cassava. In general, sub-district in Aceh Tamiang District have the potential for livestock development. Based on table 4, the sub-district that have a great opportunity were Karang Baru and Bendahara sub-district by producing utility potential of 2,000 tons per year and 3,000 tons per year and having capacity 2,000 ST per year and 2,000 ST per year. The sub-district that does not have the potential based on this study was the Kejuruan Muda sub-district because it don't have sufficient agricultural waste product for cattle and buffalo. It possible that breeder in this district get feed from plantation waste and other waste that can be they can be used as animal feed. Karang Baru sub-district is very big chance of adding ruminant livestock, especially buffalo as Indonesian germplasm, whose contribution to the meat self-sufficiency program was recognized in 2010. So the conclusion of this research is sub-district having a great opportunity for livestock development is Karang Baru sub-district by producing utilization potential of 2,000 tons per year and having a carrying capacity is 2,000 ST per year. Then followed by Bendahara sub-district and the sub-district doesn't have a potential based on this study is Kejuruan Muda sub-district. It possible that breeder in this sub-district get feed from Plantation West and other ways. The availability of forage is one of determining factor for the success business for breeder. So I think that's all about my presentation. Thank you for attention. I will give back to moderator.
Okay, thank you. So for the third presenter, the videos will be played. Please co-host.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon everyone. My name is Asmi Mangalisu from Universitas Muhammadiyah Sinjai, Sulawesi Province. I would like to present our article under title The Tenderness Quality of Sinjai Superior Kampung Chickens Meat by Using New Marinade of Pineapple Rind Powder at Different Marinade Time. The tenderness quality of Sinjai Superior Kampung Chickens Meat by Using Marinade of Pineapple Rind Powder at Different Marinade Time. First, about introduction, Sinjai Superior Kampung Chickens is a new phenomenon in the maintenance development in the poultry world. Sinjai Superior Kampung Chickens, which is better known as SSKC. SSKC is a type of kampung chicken. If SSKC is cut at all age, it has a top meat. So it requires special treatment in the processing process so that the meat is tender. It is hoped that the provision of pineapple rind could improve the quality of livestock products by increasing the tenderness of the meat. So it is necessary to conduct research on the effect of giving pineapple rind as an ingredient in SSKC meat marination. Pineapple rind powder had the potential to be used as an ingredient in marinating the meat tenderness. This utilization could also be a solution to reduce environmental pollution due to lack of waste treatment. Pineapple rind in this study was given in powder from the optimized the level of tenderness, reduce the additional of water to the meat and inhibit the growing of microorganisms. Next, the second about materials and method. Research design, our study was completely randomized design, CRD, factorial patterns with two treatment factors. Research procedure, the first making pineapple rind powder and the second sample preparation. Measure parameters, the first cooking loss, the second water holding capacity, and the last shear force value. Data analysis, CRD and LSD. The next result and discussion. Okay, the first cooking loss, you can see in the slide, the first table about cooking loss value percent of SSKC meat with pineapple rind powder marinate at different marinating times. The first table show that the increasing level of pineapple rind powder on SSKC meat would decrease the cooking loss value. The decrease in the value of cooking loss was caused by shocking with the enzyme bromelain, which was obtained from pineapple rind powder. The enzyme was able to hydrolyze peptide bonds in proteins into amino acids. The large number of bromelain enzyme, including of the protease enzyme, were used to break down proteins into simpler compounds so that more peptides were produced. Bromelain enzyme acts as bicatalyzed that accelerate the reaction of protein breakdown into amino acid. The higher the concentration of the added enzyme, the higher the reaction speed, so that the more peptide bonds were hydrolyzed. Consequently, more protein was hydrolyzed into amino acids. The second water holding capacity you can see in the slide. Second table about water holding capacity value, percent of SHKC meet with pinaporine powder marinate and different marinating times. The second table show that the water holding capacity value increased with increasing levels of pinaporine powder provision. The increase occurred due to the ability of the bromelain enzyme, which was found in pinaporine powder, to hydrolyze peptide bonds so as to retain water in the meat. The ability of meat to hold water was an important characteristic because with its high water holding capacity, the meat had good quality. The water holding capacity in this study was in the normal range. The water holding capacity of meat is around 20 until 16%. Protein is the component that most influence the water holding capacity of a material, although other components are also influential. And last, shear force value. You can see in the slide. The third table about shear force value of SHKC meat with pinaporine powder marinade at different marinating times. The third table shows that the shear force value decreased along with the increase in the level of pinaporine powder on SHKC meat. The decrease in the shear force value is due to the hydrolysis of collagen and myofibrils by the enzyme bromelain, causing the structure of the meat to become shorter in fragments and making the meat more tender. Enzyme performance was influenced by enzyme concentration, and the higher the enzyme count, the higher the hydrolyzed substrate. Collagen and myofibrils as substrate will be hydrolyzed by the protease enzyme. So the higher the protease enzyme used, the more collagen and myofibrils were hydrolyzed. This was also supported by research which state that the value of the shear force value with the addition of 0% pineapple extra was different from 5, 10, and 15%. The addition of 5% pineapple extra reduced the meat tenderness compared to the control, and discreetly the increased concentration increased the meat tenderness. And last conclusion, the tenderness of the rejected SHKC meat could be increased by marinating using pinaporine powder. The addition of pinaporine powder by 20% with a long marination time of 90 minutes is the best marination to improve the quality of meat tenderness. I think that's all. Thank you very much for your attention. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay, thank you co-host for playing the videos. So, now we go through to the Q&A session. So, I have one question for the first presenter to the Miss Yeni. Are you there, Miss Yeni, for the first paper with the paper ID 38090? Please open the mic, co-host, please open the mic.
Can you hear my voice clearly? Hello?
Okay. Thank you, Miss Yeni. So, the question is from Mr. Sugiono Saputra. The question is, did you observe any unique characteristics of fecal appearance of chicken supplemented with prey or probiotics? And then, any differences with regular feed? Please answering this question.
Thank you, Mr. Sugiono, for the question. This is a part of our research. So, I also observe about bacteria, but infecting, not infect out. And I use Prinsa and PRFLP for the kinds of abundance of bacteria. And there were differences between the treatment and the pathogenic. The pathogenic bacteria of basalfit was higher than prebiotic and others. And then
I'm sorry to interrupt it. Miss Yeni, could you using some microphone or headset, because the quality of your voice is not clear. Yes, okay. The quality is very low.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Hello?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Could you start from the beginning?
Oh, okay.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Sugiono, for the question. And this is the part of my study. I also observe about bacterial composition and chicken, but in cecum, not in fecal. I use RISA and TRFLP, and the result found that regular feed had higher pathogenic bacteria than prebiotic or others, and then the second, I also use NGS, but still in process, still on process. There is no have not clear about NGS because still on process. And this is about the bacteria. I use it. I apply it in journal. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for your answer, Miss Yeni. I hope, is it clear, Mr. Sugiono, if you have any question?
Just a quick question. Did you observe any smelly feces from the chicken that supplemented with probiotic? Just the appearance. Were they smelly or
smelly? Smelly probiotic.
You know, I mean.
No, the feces.
Okay. Right. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Only for second. Yep.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Sugiono and Mrs. Yeni. Okay, you can unmute again your microphone. So for the second question is to the, yes, Miss Yeni. because there is no question for you. I interesting about the agricultural in the Aceh, because I already go there for some research, and I don't know if there is any cultural based farming that affect the population of the ruminant, because when I go there is a lot of cattle in the free range, but free range in the road, in the everywhere there is any cattle that if I asking to the people, they don't know whose cattle there is. You know what I mean, right? Yes. Yeah, yes. Okay, thank you.
In Aceh Tamiang, in Aceh especially Aceh Tamiang, the cattle is not in cage. So the people and the farmer is release the cattle to search the feed like around the cage. So agricultural waste is used to site a feed in cattle, not point feed.
Okay, so in this paper, the population that you use to write it in the paper, is it just the population from the big farmer, or it is from all of the farmer, including the society?
This is the farmer in society, not big farmer.
Okay. Okay. I will thank you and appreciate your answer. And you can mute your microphone again. And there is a question for the third presenter, Miss Asmi Mangalisu.
Yes.
Yes. This is you can turn on the video.
Done.
Yeah. Okay. There is a question from Mr. Mirza. Could you please tell me the baseline data of the tenderness of SKK-CK meat? Yes, there's a question. There is the question.
Okay, thank you very much for your question. The best data of SSPC cooking loss value, the proportion pineapple, rhyme powder, and marination time optimal level was...
I'm sorry, Miss Asmi, can you please using the microphone or headset, because your voice...
I don't have, so sorry.
Okay, just talk slowly.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
About cooking loss of SSPC, marinade, the best level was 20% for 120 minutes, and the water holding capacity, the best water holding capacity value, the optimal level was 20% for 90 minutes, and the surface value, the best data for optimal level was 20% and for 90 minutes. So the tenderness of rejected SSPC meat will be increased by marinating using pineapple rind powder. The addition of pineapple rind powder by 20% with a long marination time of 90 minutes is the best marination to improve the quality of meat tenderness.
I'm sorry. Might be the question is baseline data. Baseline data of the tenderness of SSKCK meat. Like maybe is it for all of the kind of meat, the baseline data of the tenderness of the meat? Do you have? The question is, could you please tell me the baseline data?
The baseline data, this not to water holding capacity, cooking loss, 25%, but I don't in the baseline data for.
Yeah, it's okay. You maybe you could, if you already have, you could give the baseline data or something to the email, to the directly to Mr. Mirza. Maybe Mr. Mirza, could you give the email in the chat room, and then the baseline data will given by Ms. Asmi Mangalisu directly by the email. Okay, I really appreciate Mrs. Asmi Mangalisu. Thank you for the answer. Okay, this is the Okay, this is the last question for the third session. So after this, we going through to the last session, the fourth session, and I will give it to the Dr. Sastrin. Time is yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Denny. So we go to our last session today. I would like to remind you again that you can start asking questions in the chat box while watching the videos. And this discussion will be directly conducted after playing the videos. I'd like to call our last two presenters to present their work. Their presenters are paper ID 38110, The Effects of Antibiotic Growth Promoters, or AGP, on Antibiotic Resistance and the Digestive System of Brayle Chicken in Sleman, Yogyakarta, Marla Anggita, C14. And the last presenter is 38114, The Study of Pregnancy Rates, PR, Surface Per Conception, as per C, Coughing Rate, CR, and the Incidence of Dystocia in Peranakan Ungol, or PO cows, that's inseminated by various of frozen semen breeds, by Topaz, C15. So, okay, to shorten the time, please the co-host to play the videos. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Marla Anggita, and today I would like to present our study with the title of The Effect of Antibiotic Growth Promoters on Antibiotic Resistance and the Digestive System of Broiler Chicken in Sleman, Yogyakarta. In this study, we have Dr. Triuntari as the lead researcher, Dr. Okti Herawati, myself, Marla Anggita, Professor Widya Asmara, Professor Aglesia Endangtri Uni, and also Professor Michael Haryadi Wibowo. We are from Department of Microbiology, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Universitas Gadjah Mada, Indonesia. So for the introduction, chicken is a major source of animal protein consumption in Indonesia. And the main problem facing the poultry industry is the incidence of resistance in the bacteria, which increases mortality of the chicken production. One of the causes of resistance occurred is the use of antibiotics as the feed additives. So this is the framework of antimicrobial resistance associated with poultry production and also the human health. So the resistance can be transferred to other animals or humans through direct contact, animal products or indirectly via environmental pathways. The use of antibiotics in feed additives has contributed in the occurrence of antibiotic resistance in the poultry farm. These antibiotic growth promoters was claimed to improve the feed conversion, stimulate growth, and also to reduce the risk of death in livestock. However, the mechanism of antibiotics as growth promoters are still unknown. The antimicrobial use in poultry production, moreover, also contributes to the dissemination, selection, and persistence of antimicrobial resistance in human population. So the understanding of the effects of using antibiotic growth promoters in broiler chicken, especially against antibiotic resistance, and also the effect in the digestive tract need to be carried out in the community to avoid the impacts on resistance and economic losses. This study aims to prove an understanding of the effects of the use of antibiotic growth promoters on antibiotic resistance and the digestive tract of broiler chickens. So the study was carried out at Broiler Chicken Farm in Sleman, Yogyakarta, and we used a total of 30 chickens. So for the antibiotic resistant test in cloaca soap samples, first we collect the cloacal swabs of chickens, and then we cultured on blood agar plate. And then we incubated the plate for 24 hours. The isolated colonies were taken from 4 to 5 colonies that have the same morphology. Then we planted in triptych soy broth. And then we incubated the inoculum, reached a turbidity equal to 0.5 McFarland standard. The inoculum were cultured then in Weller-Hinton agar using sterile swab, and we put the 5 kinds of antibiotic. This first one is gentamicin, tetracycline, streptomycin, amoxicillin, and also the erythromycin. We placed the disc on the surface of the agar after we cultured the bacteria, and then we incubated for 24 hours. And then we determined the resistance based on the zone of inhibition form compared with the standards recommended by the Clinical Standards Laboratory Institute. And then we examine the histopathologic of the intestine. We collect the intestine part, the duodenum, jejunum, and ileum, and then we fixate in the formalin. After that, we stain the tissues using the hematoxylin eosin staining. This is the result of the prevalence of antibiotic resistance of bacteria from chicken cloacal swab. So here we can see that the tetracycline has a very high resistance against the bacteria from the cloacal swab of the broiler chicken. And then erythromycin, 60% from the samples. And then the amoxicillin, 60%. And streptomycin, 50%. And there's no resistant occur with against the gentamicin. So the result was substantially higher than the study conducted by Breakup et al. That found the antibiotic resistance of E. coli isolates from poultry production against tetracycline, streptomycin, and amoxicillin were 78.12%, 36.39% and 1.32% respectively. The antimicrobial resistance of bacteria in poultry can occur from the uncontrolled use of antibiotics as EP, and also because the preconized antibiotic-resistant bacteria that already exist in the poultry. The increased number of resistance against amoxicillin, clavulanate, and then cephalotin, cefotaxime, and gentamicin also found in farm birds, including poultry, by Roe Magnus et al. At 2002. And this is the histopathological result of broiler chicken intestine. The picture A showed the histopathological of intestine of chicken that feed without AGP. And B is feed with AGP. And here we can see that in the intestine of chicken that feed without AGP, there's an infiltration of inflammatory cells. But here in the intestine of the chicken feed with AGP, there's no inflammatory cells for infiltration. So based on the histopathological result of the digestive tract of chickens that were given antibiotics as AGP, there was no inflammation occurs. But the administration of antibiotics in AGP caused the antibiotic resistance in various types of antibiotics, including tetracycline, 90% of resistance, streptomycin, 60% of resistance, amoxicillin, 50% of resistance, erythromycin, 80% of resistance, tends occur for gentamicin. So the conclusion, the administration of antibiotics as a growth promoter in chicken farms does not cause inflammation in the intestine of chicken, but causes antibiotic resistance. And the antibiotic resistance of bacteria from cloaca swab of broiler chicken feed with AGP against the tetracycline was 90%, followed by erythromycin, 80%, amoxicillin 60%, streptomycin 50%, and no resistance against gentamicin. Indonesia has a very limited data on antibiotic use in poultry production and the antimicrobial resistant bacterial strains in poultry. So further studies on the bacterial strains and surveillance on antibiotic use in poultry will be important to reduce the use of AGP in poultry farm. I would like to say thank you to the Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Gajah Mada University, for the support found of this research. I would like to say thank you also for the ICFES committee to give me the opportunity to share our study in this international conference. And for the last, thank you for all of the audience to give me your attention during my presentation. Stay healthy and have a good day. Thank you.
Thank you. We go to the last video today. Please, the co-host to play.
Hello, everyone. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning. I want to introduce myself. My name is Topas Wijaksono Prior. I'm from Department of Reproduction and Obstetry, Universitas Gajah Mada, Indonesia. On behalf my senior researcher, Dr. Agung Budianto. Okay, today I want to present the study of pregnancy rate, cervix preconception, calving rate, and the incidence of dystocia rangkaian ongol cow that inseminated by various of frozen semen breed. Okay, in introduction, the first one. Problem of developing livestock in Indonesia is the problem of backyard or The euphoria of crossbreed cattle in Indonesia with increasing insemination using limousin and simmental frozen semen. In Indonesia, basically artificial insemination was applied intensive since 1974 with the aim of improving the genetic of local cattle in Indonesia and the efficiency of raising bull as well as integrated genetic improvement throughout Indonesia more quickly. This test is frequently used in the dairy more rapidly improve this desired characteristic through intensive genetic selection. Okay, the value of crossbreeding in livestock species has been known for a long time. As long as the crossbred cow population constitute less than 50% of the whole population, and young bulls can be tested through crossbred offspring, this prerequisite can be fulfilled. Offspring of cattle that inseminate by crossbred semen same time initiate the dystocia. Moreover, this case will decrease the income of farmer. The harm of the case such as mother death, calf death. If it was cesarean surgery, it will require a lot money and the post-operation was not very good. Immediate or long-term consequence due to dystocia can turn the effort uneconomical and wasteful and the fire. Crossbreeding can increase dairy income, especially in management system require is high level of functional trait. Pregnancy rate in cow is influenced by the good artificial insemination process and the quality of frozen semen male is an important factor. Furthermore, limousin and simmental frozen semen are took to have a negative effect on calf size during pregnancy because they have big body size than the local cattle in Indonesia, which cause dystocia when offspring. Further crossbreed are feared to result in failure of fertilization and implantation. Reproductive benefit of crossbreed dairy cattle may be able to alleviate some economic pressure currently associated with poor dairy reproduction with artificial insemination breeding strategy. The goal of crossbreeding can have a positive impact with the correct breeding method and artificial technique. The possibility of negative effect can be eliminated. There are differences of opinion and very less information from previous study in Indonesia regarding study of crossbreeding and the consequence. This study is expected to provide scientific information about crossbreed in Indonesia using PO cattle, which is common throughout in Indonesia. Okay, in material method, this study used 96 PO core for study design. All of them, the first one have a good reproductive health, the second one age between 3 to 8 years old, the third one have a good normal sign of estrus, the fourth one is ever pregnant. In the first study, we use 50 cow and 46 PO cow. In the second study, we are divided into 3 treatment group. It's group inseminated with PO, simmental, and limousin frozen semen straw. The frozen semen straw come from Center of Artificial Insemination in Indonesia, which has a SNI standard, and the insemination is carried out the end of estrus and the beginning of met estrus by rectovaginal method. The maximum number of insemination is 3 times cervix until pregnant. Pregnancy was examined using the rectal method at the second month post-insemination. In the first research, data taken was the number of pregnant or pregnancy rate and the number of cervix until they become pregnant or cervix preconception. The second study, the data taken was the number of cow born from all of pregnant cow and the number of incidents of dystocia during calving. All data we are analyzed using chi-square to find out any difference between group. This is a result and discussion. In table 1, so artificial insemination success level using variet straw to PO cattle in Yogyakarta. The result of data analyzed using the chi-square indicated there was no difference significantly in all parameter between treatment group. In table 2, show calving rate and incident rate of dystocia in PO cattle which inseminated by variet straw. The normal calving rate is 60 until 70%. So that PO cow had the excellent result of the calving rate. The results indicate there was no difference significantly in all parameters within treatment group. Variation of semen breed, the inseminated to PO cow has no disorder effect. And then the conclusion, the first one, PO cattle are known as beef cattle and drug cattle. There are suitable drug animal due to big and strong body, docile and quiet, tolerant to heat, have high adaptability over different environmental condition, able to grow in limited forage condition, and high reproductive activity. The female quickly return to normal condition after giving birth. PO cow have well adaptable and have excellent reproductive anatomy, physiology, so that they can support the process of fertilization, pregnancy, and calving. Variation of semen breed that inseminated to PO cow has no disorder effect on pregnancy and calving. Okay, this is my presentation. This is my presentation. I say thank you.
Okay, thank you, co-host, for playing the video. So we go to the last discussion today for the two presenters. Before we start, I'd like to remind you again to fill in the attendance form that's linked stated in the chat box. And you can also start asking your question in the chat room with the format name of the presenter, your question, and your email. Maybe especially for the second presenter, because here we already have two questions for the first presenters. Marla, are you ready to answer a question? Are you there, Marla? Yes.
Hello, can you hear my voice?
Oh, hello, I can hear you. So the first question is, when did you conducted the study? As far as I know, AGP in poultry is officially banned about 2 years ago. Is this practice still happening in Indonesia? And the second question is, bacteria were not identified in your study. How do you interpret it? Inhibition zone diameter or IZT, because interpretation based on CLSE is species specific. This is from Mr. Supriyadi. Okay, please tell your story.
Okay, I'm sorry. First, I would like to say thank you to Dr. Sastrin as our moderator for this session. And then thank you for the question for Mr. Sugiono. I would like to explain, but if my answer is not clear yet, we can continue from via email. Okay, for the first one, when did you conduct this study? We conducted around 2020 at September. The use of AGP is already banned in Indonesia, but unfortunately for some traditional farm, they haven't really leave the use of AGP at their farm, because it will be a big loss if they suddenly stop the use of the AGP. Many consultants try to make the use of AGP constantly being reduced. So it's not like totally stop, but we reduce the use of the AGP. But yes, in some of the traditional, they still use even it's already 2 years banned in Indonesia. And then for the second question, the bacteria were not identified. Yes, we used the whole sample of the feces from the chicken from the farm, and we used the inhibition zone diameter criteria for the enterobacter from the GSLI. So it's not really like specific bacteria, but it's for the whole enterobacter. And you can find it on GSLI for the standard of inhibition zone diameter from the GSLI. We use the enterobacter.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Marla. Yeah. So we go to the next question from Istiana Fida for you. One, did the AGP was given consciously as a treatment to observe this effect to AMR in broiled chicken, or is it just a surface study in the broiled farm? And then second question, could you explain more about the difference of AMR rate results in E. coli compared to salmonella? Thank you. Sorry, please unmute your...
Okay, okay, I'm so sorry. Okay. Okay, for her. I'm so sorry because the host was mute me when I...
Yeah, me too.
Okay. Okay, for the first question, did the AGP was given consciously? No, we observed it's a surface study. So we get the chicken samples from the traditional farm who still use the AGP as the feed additive in their farm. But we have a control of the chicken that not being fed with the AGP. So we didn't give the AGP to observe it. And the second question, I'm so sorry, but we didn't do the bacteria specification of the bacteria between the E. coli and the salmonella. So maybe I can't answer this, because we used the whole sample of feces and we used the enterobacter as the standard for the bacteria to measure the inhibition zone diameter. But it's a good, it's a good idea. Maybe we will try to make it more specific for our next research to differentiate the species of bacteria. I see the response from Mr. Sugiono. Yes, it's quite a sad thing that in Indonesia we still have a farm that still practice the given of AGP for the feed additive. But I'm sure that it will constantly reduce at the traditional farm. We hope that in the future, the use of the AGP will be stopped totally in the farm, chicken farm, especially in the traditional farm. That's all. Thank you. I give it back to Dr. Sastrim.
Oh, Okay, the host also unmute myself, so I cannot unmute myself. Okay, thank you very much, Marla, for your nice answers. And it's also interesting that practice is still happening in Indonesia. It's really sad to know. Sorry for Dr. Yen, Ms. Yeni. Maybe Marla will answer via email because it's already run out of time. Maybe we can continue to the second questions for Mr. Topaz. Are you there? Oh, I don't see you. Or okay, well, we wait. Maybe we can.
Yes,
Mr. Agung. Oh, Dr. Agung, sorry.
Yeah, I'm the team of.
Yeah, because Topaz was presenting the.
Yeah.
Presentation. So I don't see any person here asking a question, but. I want to ask you, Dr. Agung, how are you? Long time no see.
Yes, thank you very much. Yeah, you look beautiful. Yeah.
Thank you.
You look good as well.
So I just wondering, like in your conclusion, you mentioned that the Peranakan Ongol cows have well. Adaptable and have excellent reproductive anatomy and physiology so that they can support the process of fertilization and pregnancy and calving. Did you actually study like comparing the anatomy and physiology among breeds before, or do you know a study like saying that PO has
conclusion,
excellent yes. reproductive anatomy and physiology? Yes.
Actually, we not concentrate on the anatomy morphology, but considering this research, that you know that in Indonesia we AI, we call EP with many kind of breeds, and the excellent what I said the excellent for PO because even they give the Limousine or Simmental is a big breed of AI. But all of them is not become the dystocia. It means the mother after implantation, they dominant and control the size of the cattle. Even though the phenotype will be dominant by the Limousine and Simmental. But is all is dominant by the PO. This is very, very interesting. So that's why. If the PO be inseminated with the Limousine and Simmental, everybody said that this is very dangerous because become the oversize and dystocia. But according this research, if we inseminate in the mother, not in the heifer or in the prepubertal cattle, no dystocia at all. So 90% all is calving safely without the dystocia. It means that the adaptation and the dominance of the genetic are very, very good by the PO cattle. So the important thing by this research is that don't worry about the crossbreed. The important thing is the condition of the mother. So because the mother, the PO mother, can control all the size of the cattle. And number two. The second one is the even the smaller, the size of body smaller, but in the pelvis and or sacrum, all is the bigger compared with another breed. So that's why even the cattle is small, the size are small, but they are good for the delivery, the cattle, even 30 kilo, 25 kilos. That's like, I think it's like say, Indonesian people. Even they
really?
They can deliver the baby normally. It's amazing.
They mix breed with the Westerners.
So, Justin, don't worry. you
no problem. Well, I'm married with Indonesian, not the Westerners.
Oh yeah,
doctor.
I thought you will be cross because.
No, no.
Oh no, yes. That is important. That's why. Thank you, Kasrin. That I want to mention that this conclusion is not because if we compare the anatomy, but we compare by the performance reproduction, especially after the crossbreed and the delivery or the calving of the mother of PO. That's my explanation.
Okay, thank you. Okay. That's very interesting. So the genetic of PO is more dominant, especially the mother.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Agung. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you. Thank you. Very nice.
Thank you.
Many thanks, Dr. Agung.
Yes.
Yeah.
Really?
Yes, thank you. Really, thank you.
Okay, I think that's all for the last session today. So for the closing, I will give it back to Dr. Denny. Please, Dr. Denny.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Sastrin. That's all for the parallel session today. But before we leave the room in this session, we going to take a picture first before we leave for the documentation. So please on your cam, turn on your cam, all of participant and presenter to okay. Everyone, please co-host to. Oh, it's okay. Yes, already. All right. Please. Okay. It's all. Or waiting for a second. I think it's already for a second. Okay. I think it's already even not all of the participants, but this it's okay. Okay. You can give a big smile and we will take a picture for the documentation, for the documentation. Okay, please co-host, just take a picture. Yeah, you can give us a big smile, please. Okay. Okay, it's already finished this parallel session today. So we will close the session today. I really thank you for your attention and for your really kindness today. So today you can leave the from room and we will see you tomorrow in the next parallel session. I hope if you have some question to the presenter before, you can go to the email directly to the presenter so you can get the clearly answer. So thank you so much. Good afternoon. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. You can leave the meeting room. Thank you.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Bye.
See you tomorrow.
Bye.
Bye.
Ya, alhamdulillah.
Oke, tetap malam dan semuanya. Yeah.
Terima kasih, Dok.
Silakan istirahat, minum dulu ya. Okay. Supaya imunnya naik ya.
Oke.
Okay. Irham masih di sini ya.
Iya. Pak Sarmin juga nggih. Pak Erif.
Oh ya, Dr. Eri ada wah ini. Ada. Hubungan lemu-lemu ini. Kan?
Saya juga, Bu Dok.
Oh ya, wow.
Saya juga. Oh, saya juga lemu. Juga, Pak.
Oke,
terima kasih.
Saya
pamit. Yeah, terima kasih. Yeah.
Terima kasih,
Dok. Terima kasih, Dok. Yeah, Dok, sehat selalu semuanya.
Sehat selalu, Dok.
Mas Yud ini.
Oke, Pak Irau.
Ya, mantan dulu.
Oke, sami-sami, Pak.
Ya, Pak. Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih. Moderator dan co-host.
Iya, makasih Mbak Marla.
Sama-sama, Mbaknya. Marla. Oh, iya.
jangan lupa itu ya, Vista Center. Terima kasih semua, sampai jumpa.
Oke. Okay.